Hello, good afternoon, and thanks for joining me for this Alumni Association webinar. My name is Rebecca Nolen, and I am the Infectious Diseases and Antimicrobial Stewardship Pharmacist at SSN St. Mary's Hospital in St. Louis. Today, I'll be discussing Shingrix, a second shot at shingles prevention. And just so you know, there is a chat box that's open for questions on the right-hand side of your screen. You're welcome to type them throughout the presentation. As you probably already know, shingles or herpes zoster is a reactivation of varicella zoster virus, which is the virus that causes chickenpox. The varicella zoster virus stays dormant in the dorsal root ganglia and can reactivate years later, which causes shingles. About one-third of patients who have had chickenpox will get the shingles. Shingles can spread from person to person through direct contact with the rash blisters, and once the rash has developed crust, the person is no longer infectious. Shingles is less contagious than chickenpox, but anyone who has once had the chickenpox is susceptible to virus reactivation and development of the shingles. Patients with shingles typically present with a rash on one side of their body or face, and this can persist for 2 to 4 weeks. Usually presentation is a single stripe around the left or right side of the body. It can also occur on one side of the face. It's typically painful or itchy, and the onset of these symptoms are about 1 to 5 days prior to the rash appearing. Shingles blisters will typically scab over, and this takes about 7 to 10 days. Some other common symptoms that patients tend to experience include fever, headache, chills, and upset stomach. The graph on this slide depicts the incidence of shingles since the early 1990s. In patients who are 65 years of age and older. So the CDC estimates that the incidence of shingles is about 10 per 1,000 U.S. persons annually among people 60 years and older. As you can see here, there has been a gradual increase in the incidence of shingles since the early 1990s, although the CDC mentions they're unsure of the reason for this. An estimated 1 million cases of herpes zoster are diagnosed in the U.S. every year. Herpes zoster can recur, but the recurrence rate is unknown. Around 1 to 4% of patients with herpes zoster will be hospitalized for their complications, and hospitalization is more common in our older patients and also our patients who are immunocompromised. The most common complication of shingles is postherpetic neuralgia, or PHN. PHN is defined by severe pain at the rash site, even when the rash clears up. The pain can last for several months to years. And the incidence of PHN after development of shingles increases with older age, and this is depicted in the graph on the right. And the rate is in rate per 1,000 person years. So the dark blue shows the rate of PHN among various age groups, and this shows a significant increase in PHN in patients 70 years of age and older. Approximately 13% of patients 60 years of age and older with shingles will develop PHN. Some other less common complications include vision loss, bacterial infection of the lesions, cranial and peripheral nerve palsies, meningoencephalitis, pneumonitis, hepatitis, and acute renal necrosis. Most of you are probably familiar with the Zostavax vaccine, which is a live attenuated varicella zoster virus vaccine. Zostavax was FDA approved in 2006 for patients 50 years of age and older for the prevention of herpes zoster. It's stored frozen and must be reconstituted. It's also given as one dose administered subcutaneously. Zostavax is not indicated for the prevention of primary varicella infection or for treatment of zoster or postherpetic neuralgia. It's also really important to note that it's contraindicated in immunosuppressed patients and pregnant patients due to the fact that the vaccine is live. Patients who are immunosuppressed who receive the vaccination can develop disseminated zoster, which could be fatal. And lastly, a single dose of the Zostavax is about $210. In contrast to Zostavax, Shingrix is a recombinant varicella zoster vaccine that was FDA approved in 2017 for the prevention of herpes zoster in patients 50 years of age and older. This vaccine is also reconstituted, but it is refrigerated. Another difference is that it's given in a two-dose series, and the doses are given 2 to 6 months apart, and it is administered intramuscularly. Shingrix is also not indicated for the prevention of primary varicella infection. The cost of the two-dose series is similar but slightly higher at $256. And of note, Shingrix is composed of a varicella zoster virus glycoprotein E and a novel adjuvant system called AS01B. The only contraindication on the package insert is a history of allergic reaction to Shingrix or any component of the vaccine. Warnings and precautions include not administering Shingrix during an acute episode of herpes zoster, as the vaccine does not treat herpes zoster or postherpetic neuralgia. It's also important to review immunization history for possible vaccine sensitivity prior to the administration of the vaccine. There's currently no data in pregnancy, as pregnant patients have been excluded so far from all of the studies. It's also unknown whether Shingrix is excreted in human milk, and there's currently no data which assess the effects of Shingrix on a breastfed infant. The main study that led to FDA approval of Shingrix was the ZOE 50 study, which was published by Lal and colleagues in 2015. This was a randomized placebo-controlled phase 3 study in 18 countries, including the United States. Patients were included if they were 50 years of age and older. Patients who were excluded included patients who were pregnant or immunocompromised, including patients who were HIV positive, had malignancy, or were on immunosuppressive medications. Additional exclusion criteria included patients who had a history of herpes zoster, were previously vaccinated against varicella or herpes zoster, and survival was not expected to be 4 years or longer. Patients were given 2 doses of Shingrix 2 months apart or 2 doses of 0.9% NS 2 months apart. The primary objective was to assess efficacy of the vaccine at preventing herpes zoster compared to the placebo, which you can see in the table at the bottom of the slide. In the cohort that included all patients, the vaccine was 97% efficacious. And splitting that up into the different age groups, in patients 50 to 59 years old, it was 96.6% efficacious. 60 to 69 years old was 97% efficacious, and greater than 70 years old was 97.9%. A second identical clinical trial was published by Cunningham and colleagues, which included patients 70 years or older, and this was a ZOE 70 study. The average age for the ZOE 70 study was about 76.9 years old. Overall efficacy was 89.8%, and if you break this down into the two age categories that they looked at, efficacy was 90% in patients 70 to 79 years old, and 89.1% in patients 80 years of age or older. And it's important to note the follow-up period for both trials was 4 years post-administration of the second vaccination. The efficacy of the vaccine over time was also assessed in the ZOE 70 study. This table includes only patients in the ZOE 70 study. The data was similar in the pooled ZOE 50 and ZOE 70 data, including patients who are 70 years of age and older. As you can see in the table, the efficacy of the vaccine was highest in the first year after vaccination and decreased slightly by year 4 to 85.1%. So this decrease, in my opinion, is not insignificant. However, it is a smaller decline in efficacy compared to Zostavax, which we'll see on the next slide. It's also important to note that the trial only followed up with patients for 4 years after vaccine administration, so additional follow-up is warranted regarding the persistence of vaccine protection over a longer period of time. Although there are no head-to-head studies comparing Shingrix and Zostavax, I included a comparison of the efficacy of both vaccines across various age groups. As you can see, vaccine efficacy for both vaccines declined as patients aged, but efficacy remained above 90% in patients who received Shingrix. Patients who received Zostavax had a sharper decline in efficacy, starting at 70% for patients 50 to 59 years old, and dipping as low as 18% for patients greater than 80 years old. The ZOE 70 study also looked at the incidence of postherpetic neuralgia in both arms of the trial. The incidence of PHN was low in both arms at 0.1 per 1,000 person years in the vaccine group and 0.9 per 1,000 person years in the placebo group. Overall vaccine efficacy against PHN among adults 50 years of age and older was about 91%. There were no diagnoses of PHN in any patients that were less than 70 years of age who received the vaccine. So the efficacy in patients less than 70 years old was 100%. Efficacy in patients 70 to 79 years old was 93%, and patients 80 years or older was 71%. In the shingles prevention study, Zostavax had appeared to provide additional protection against postherpetic neuralgia beyond providing herpes zoster protection, but the authors of the ZOE 70 study concluded there's not evidence for additional efficacy of Shingrix against PHN among vaccine recipients who had breakthrough shingles. And they concluded that the protection against postherpetic neuralgia was driven solely by a lower incidence of shingles in patients who received Shingrix. Moving on to the safety of Shingrix, the incidence of ADRs was fairly high in both the ZOE 70 and ZOE 50 studies. Patients less than 70 years of age tended to report more ADRs than patients 70 years of age and older. Also, a majority of the ADRs had a median duration of 2 to 3 days and were mild in intensity for patients receiving Shingrix. Again, this table compares ADRs associated with Shingrix and Zostavax, which is pooled data from both package inserts. You can see the rate of pain with Shingrix is about 78%, which is higher than Zostavax, but the rate of erythema and swelling was slightly lower with Shingrix. As far as general or systemic ADRs, rates of myalgia, fatigue, headache, fever, and GI side effects were all higher in patients who received Shingrix. So although the vaccines were not directly compared, ADRs do seem to be more likely with Shingrix than patients who received Zostavax. The CDC Advisory Council on Immunization Practices, or ACIP, released a recommendation earlier this year and recommended Shingrix for all immunocompetent adults aged 50 years and older. The council also preferred Shingrix over Zostavax and recommended Shingrix for all immunocompetent adults who previously received Zostavax. The trials did not specifically study the administration of Shingrix in patients who had received Zostavax in the previous 5 years, but based on expert opinion, they recommended to wait 2 months after administration of Zostavax to administer Shingrix. Shingrix can be administered with influenza and pneumococcal vaccines. However, concomitant administration of two adjuvanted vaccines, such as Shingrix and Fluad, have not been evaluated. Shingrix can also still be used in adults who are on low doses of immunosuppressive therapy, and this is defined as prednisone less than 20 milligrams per day or equivalent. It can also still be used in patients who are anticipating immunosuppression or who have recovered from immunocompromising illnesses. The only times we would consider using Zostavax are in adults 60 years of age or older, if they're allergic to Shingrix, if they prefer Zostavax for some reason, or if they require immediate vaccination and Shingrix is for some reason unavailable. One question that may come up in community or ambulatory care settings is insurance coverage. Most companies should be covering Shingrix by April if they're not already. It's important to note that Medicare covers Shingrix as a Part D benefit, so immunizations will need to be given in community pharmacies for Medicare patients. I also have listed some general patient education tips to give your patients a better understanding of the vaccine, and this includes discussing the percentage of people at risk for shingles and the efficacy of the new vaccine. It's also beneficial to educate patients on the need for Shingrix, even if they've already received Zostavax. The Immunization Action Coalition, or IAC, also has recommendations for attenuating ADRs related to the vaccine, including a cold compress for localized reactions and analgesics or antipruritics if needed. It might also be helpful to educate patients that the mean duration of symptoms is 2 to 3 days so they know what to expect. In summary, Zostavax is a live attenuated vaccine, whereas Shingrix is not a live vaccine. Zostavax is administered subcutaneously, and Shingrix is intramuscular. Overall efficacy is 51% for Zostavax and about 97% for Shingrix. ADRs seem to occur more in patients receiving Shingrix. The cost is fairly similar at $210 for a dose of Zostavax and $256 for the series of Shingrix. Zostavax is stored frozen while Shingrix is stored in the refrigerator. And ACIP now recommends Shingrix over Zostavax, and the age cutoff for the ACIP recommendation is 50 years or older for Shingrix, Well, it's 60 years or older for Zostavax. And with that, I want to thank you for joining me. If you have any questions, you can enter those into the chat box. If not, I put my email on this slide as well. If you have any questions, feel free to email me, and I'm happy to discuss. Thanks, and have a great afternoon.